Good morning, good afternoon, good evening, everyone, and welcome to today's last webinar of the year. My name is Matthias Greschel, and I'm really excited to open today's webinar with Nigam Shah and Zach Kohani here under the umbrella of AI for Good. AI for Good is the UN's leading initiative to understand how AI can help achieve the Sustainable Development Goals. And these webinars are hosted together by the Focus Group on AI for Health and Harvard Medical School's Department of Biomedical Informatics. In the series, we try to cover relevant aspects and challenges in data-driven research. For example, last time we heard about how bias can affect an image classifier of X-rays, or how many of the published models to predict COVID are not really useful when really tested in the real world. We've also heard about the challenges of implementing AI solutions in Brazil, and I think today's talk will also focus more on the implementation side. I have the huge privilege of introducing the session today, Bringing Machine Learning to Clinical Use Safely, Ethically, and Cost-Effectively by Nigam Shah. But before I hand over to Zach, I first want to introduce your moderator today, Zach Kohani. Zach is the inaugural chair and professor at the Department of Biomedical Informatics at Harvard Medical School. Zach trained as a pediatric endocrinologist and received his PhD in computer science during what he always calls the second heyday of artificial intelligence. Zach believes that medicine is at its core a knowledge processing discipline, and his research agenda has thus really focused on how to leverage the healthcare enterprise to derive new knowledge and generate innovation around this. But most of all, Zach is a great mentor, a big role model to his younger colleagues, and a fantastic book club organizer. And with no further ado, I'll hand it over to Zach, and please add any missing parts to the introduction, and then feel free to hand over to Nigam. Thank you. Oh, you're muted, Zach. You have to unmute.
As you well know, I am rarely muted. So thank you for putting that out. Matthias, that was a really nice introduction. I have nothing to add. That was very, very generous on your part. So I'm really excited about today's speaker because Professor Nigam Shah is doing things which I think are insufficiently done in the field of AI and medicine, which is he's actually building systems that make a difference. And I don't know if he'll talk to us about his green button efforts, for example, which have transformed, I think, created a transformative model of how we look at data from our very own healthcare organization in how we thereby look at interesting, challenging patients. I think I would be remiss if I did not do, in light of what you just did, Matthias, if I did not do a more fulsome, introduction of Nigam. So first, and I apologize, Nigam, I'm not gonna be able to pronounce the name of your medical school. I'll try Maharajas Saya Hirao University, where he got his medical degree. And you'll correct me later. He got his PhD in biosciences, computational biology, and ontology at Penn State University, then did his postdoctoral work at Stanford. And what I did not know, he became an associate dean. That's impressive. Back in 2019, and I'm very pleased to see a full professor in 2020. I also did not know, but I think it's absolutely essential that we have more people like Nigam taking this on. He's Associate Chief Information Officer at Stanford Healthcare. And I think that combination is both reflects where he comes from in terms of what he's trying to do, but also it's an acknowledgement of the power he brings to his work. And so, Nigam, I could go on, but I have to say, you're exactly the kind of leader we want in medicine, leading us forward to, in fact, make medicine more like the information processing discipline it should be. And I'd love to hear how you think about it. So, Nigam, over to you.
OK,
Okay, can you hear me? All right, so my internet is a bit glitchy. So if I cut in and out, we'll just take a 30 second hit and live with it. So thank you, Zach, for the awesome introduction. I would say that Zach is the person whose career I try to follow and say, what would Zach do today? So he's a great inspirer for people of the next generation. And so today, what I'm going to try and do, so let me set up my screen sharing because I do it a slightly weird way. And we tested it, so hopefully it'll still work. There we go. And it's not refreshing, so that's not good. Okay. And now it's showing the wrong slides. Come on. There we go. Okay. So I will touch a little bit on the Green Button Project. It will be mentioned, Zach, but today the focus is going to be more on what I'm working on next. And this is meant more to be a conversation. I tend to go slow. The goal is to not finish all the slides, but to have enough fodder for a rich discussion at the end. So that's how we'll handle this. To build on what Zach was chatting about, I split my...
Nigam, if people want to interrupt you and if they post a question, do you want me, it's up to you. Do you want me to reserve the questions to the end or do you want me to interrupt you?
I would say the interruption and sort of handle it right there. And I'll trust your judgment on what is worth while to address right then and what we can punt. All right. So the perspective I bring to you today arises from my almost schizophrenic life. So I split my time three ways. Half of it is me as a professor. And then the other half is partly with the School of Medicine, so that's here, and partly with the health system, that's here. And that three-way split gives a unique lens on what matters and in what way. And that's what I'm hoping to share with you today. And I'll begin with acknowledgments. This is a fabulous team that makes everything that I'm going to be possible. And of course, funding from a variety of federal agencies, NLM being my main supporter. The institutional support from my department and the health system and so on, and a couple of generous donors. All right, so one of the most important things I would like to share with you is that we have to start taking what I call this timeline view of patient data. Most of the time when someone says data, the thing that comes to mind is tables or images or text documents or ECGs or, whatever is your fancy, depending on the field you come from. But the view that matters from a patient perspective is this journey going from left to right. And the red dots on here are some events of consequence. And then depending on where you are in the healthcare ecosystem, you will get data from the venerated age-old claims and coded data, which in the US are fragmented. And if you're in Europe and in some of the Scandinavian countries, the registry is amazing. Increasingly, you can get detail in the form of ICD codes, medications, procedure codes. You might get laboratory tests and their results. You might get some documents if you're lucky. Depending on the health system, you might get continuous monitoring in the form of bedside monitors or wearables integrated from the user and get molecular data. Now we're stepping outside of the healthcare system, so there might be phone usage, browsing history, social media, audio recordings, and so on. So you can imagine, 50, 80 different tracks of information like this that are being collected on a person. And actually, Griffin Weber, working with Zach, had a nice paper in JAMA almost 8 years ago now on what are the different forms of data, structured, unstructured, medical, societal, and so on, that we're capturing on people. The ones you see on the screen are ones that I've actually worked with myself. And so Akia's projects are by analyzing phone usage and using that to anticipate someone's health services needs next 60 days out, and based on that, show them some differential offers in terms of where can they go for their annual checkups. And analyzing audio recordings of psychotherapy sessions to see what constitutes good therapy. Anyway, the point here, there's things happening over time, and depending on where you live, you get a tiny sliver of it. There is no entity that has all the tracks on me. And there is no entity that has a complete track, even something as simple as claims, all the way for me. These two things remain constant. Now, with that fragmentation and all of that, like, we have these, let's just call this a patient timeline object. We have these for millions of people. And the challenge now is to use the data at our disposal to automate something tedious, and 80, 90% of AI today is of that ilk. Let me read your X-ray for you, or your retinal scan for you, or have some bedside monitoring that gives you early warning for sepsis and that kind of stuff, what I call intra-encounter AI. And then there are approaches, you know, let's say the remaining 20%, where the goal is to look across everything you have to then do something we could not do before. Anticipate cancer, anticipate heart attacks, anticipate falls, and take proactive action. So that's what we're gonna talk about today. I will not spend that much time talking about intra-encounter AI for the very simple reason that there's enough on it out there already, and it's already at the stage of starting to move into production use. We're gonna be talking about what comes next. So if you subscribe to this view, this multiple tracks of information to either automate or make a prediction or a forecast that allows us to take early action. But at the end of the day, underneath that is a model. And when I say the word model, I mean an equation, a function that links one to millions of inputs to an output. So a simple, you know, fx that links x's to y. That's what I mean by a model. Now in healthcare, we use that model to do one of two things. And I jokingly refer to this as the equation of medicine. If the risk of something is above a certain threshold, then, you know, do x, take action. And the most concrete forms of these are if the 10-year risk of an acute cardiovascular event is greater than 7.5%, then prescribe 40 milligrams of atorvastatin. Cardiology is amongst the few places where you get as concrete things like that, where the risk estimate, the threshold, and the action are completely clarified. The majority of the time, what's going to be happening is clear threat. Min supply threat action. And I think I might have lost slides. Are you still seeing my slides?
No, the internet got choppy.
All right, so let's start that again. Comcast never fails to disappoint. There we go. Okay. Talking about and the model helping us do one of these two things. Strategy could, from a medical standpoint, as either making a classification of what the patient already has, or making a forecast of what the patient is going to have. And I just lost slides again, but I mean, it's the same thing. So I'll start sharing in a couple of seconds. And the guidance of the choice is what's typically viewed as an inference problem. Particularly, you would want causal inference in that setting, so that when you give someone advice saying, you know, prescribe 40 milligram atorvastatin, you know that the effect of that is going to be something you're sure of. So with that lens, I call this equation of medicine, and then I split my work along the same lines. So what we had on the upper half was efforts that aid in risk stratification, which guides the decisions of whether to act. And at the bottom was the green button project that Zach had mentioned, which guides the decision of how to act. All right, so now let's see if the computer gods are going to work with us again. If not, I'll just go over to the old-fashioned screen sharing, and I'll lose the ability to write on my slides, but it will be easier and less disruptive.
That's probably a smart idea, Nigam.
All right, it's not working.
Yeah, I'll give it up just to go back to the old stuff.
All right, yeah, let's do that. This is not going to, we'll keep interrupting. So give me just 1 second and I'll go over to the regular way of showing slides.
We don't live yet in a completely Zoom compatible world.
Okay, so I have that. Sorry about that. And now hopefully this will last. Okay, can you see the slides? Okay, so that's the equation I was walking you all through. And the part on the upper left is what we'll focus on for the majority of today. And the lower right is that green button project, which is let's look at what our patients like and produce a report that goes back to the clinician in order to aid their decision-making. That project is sort of now completed, and we spun it out as a company called Atropos Health. Okay. So no matter which of those two things you're doing, underneath is this thing called the model, which is in this red box here. But the model is a tiny cog in this thing that I call the workflow, and I sort of jokingly call it the almighty workflow. Because if you don't pay attention to the workflow, the model might not accrue you any benefit. There's sort of a business cliche that says, you know, culture eats strategy for breakfast. I would say the workflow eats the model for breakfast. And so what we have on screen here is just an example workflow of offering advanced care planning to a patient at our health system. It has 21 steps, 7 handoffs amongst 3 human beings, and takes 48 hours to execute. So like the exact boxes in there don't matter. You know, just to give you a flavor of the complexity, we're talking 3 human beings, 21 steps, 7 handoffs, or 2 days. Okay, so if we want to make sure that our models are useful, reliable, and fair, and I'll get to cost also in a second, we need to evaluate these innovations in a workflow-aware manner, because using a model to guide care is inextricably linked to the subsequent actions it triggers or prevents. This is sort of the most important thing. If this is all you remember from this conversation, mission accomplished. So what I mean by that is I've started to view the problem as this trinity of the model, the action or the intervention we're going to take, and its benefit. And along with benefit comes harm as well. So what you're seeing on screen is a little, you know, Mercedes-Benz kind of logo. In the middle is good AI-guided care. And I put good in quotes because honestly, as a community, we don't really know what good is. Like, we have some intuitive notion of what it should be, but I don't think anyone can articulate in a formal manner what do we mean by good. And this interplay on the top is the model and its output. So that equation linking inputs to outputs and the probability estimate it provides. The lower left is our intervention or the action and the policy on when to act, and more important, the capacity. So statins, we can assume, are an unlimited supply, but advanced care planning is not. Doing biopsies and MRIs is not. And they all have costs, and there's a finite capacity system-wide. And then the lower right is the benefit and harm of the intervention. And this is crucial because a lot of the thinking about how to use models to and in conjunction with policy decisions comes from the social sciences, where the interventions rarely have any harm. So for example, food stamps don't harm anybody. Whereas most things in medicine come with harms. If you do a biopsy, I mean, there's genuine harm that can come from that. Prostate biopsies are not just pure beneficial. And so that overlays another wrinkle in the thinking that we can't assume that just giving the intervention is net good. There's a trade-off. And to further complicate matters, that trade-off is dependent on the characteristics of the patient. So that's the interplay we have to deal with. And as a community, we've been so obsessed with the model and its output and arguing about generalizability and do we need it and when, and reliability over time and across sites, and explainability, interpretability, and fairness, and so on. And so those are the things I'm going to unpack. And in unpacking that and having done multiple projects, we'll sort of come to this worldview where we call this the delivery science for AI in healthcare. And on the bottom is a worked out example. There's also another paper with the title Delivery Science with Ron Lee as the first author. So what I mean by this is, a couple of steps, four steps. First is, what's a use case? How can we define it in the sense that given a prediction, what action is someone going to take? And then in order to drive that use case, what is the formulation of that mathematical function that's going to drive that action? Can I just reuse something existing, or do I need to learn a new one? I was shocked to learn that there are 363 equations to estimate cardiovascular risk. 363. I don't want to build a 364th one. So if we convince ourselves that, we need to build a new one, or we can reuse an existing one, the next step is model training and testing. How do we get the best function? Is that function fair? But alongside that, we also need to look at IT feasibility. Can we get the data in time to make the prediction by 6 a.m.? Because that's when, schedules get made. Because if you don't fit into that workflow and you give the prediction at 11 a.m. when everybody already has their shifts and work assigned, they're just going to ignore your prediction. We go through that. Next comes this assessment of utility. And alongside the utility assessment, we also have to analyze the capacity by looking at our workload and asking, do we have enough capacity to realize the potential net benefit that we calculate given the cost of the action and the benefit? So use that statin example. Yes, we convince ourselves there's net benefit to prescribing statins. Do we have enough doctors to give those prescriptions and enough pills? In that case, it's kind of easy that yes, that is true. But in the case of advanced care planning, it isn't always obvious. Once we go through that, the next step is to then have the model and the workflow deployed, working. You have to monitor it. Is it working as advertised? And then the lower bottom red box is, even if it's working as advertised in terms of its technical performance, is it having the impact we hoped? Because if not, we got to shut it down in a couple of months, because otherwise we're just wasting resources. So that's sort of our end to end. I promise you the colors have nothing to do with Google. That was just the default slide template that picked these nice colorful things. So when we have this view, we say, all right, the community must have done something in this space, right? There's so many people working in this. So we did a lit review saying, what are the recommendations that the community writ large has about how to do these steps? So what we're looking at here on the rows are the different proclamations or recommendations from the community. I'm guilty of being part of two of them. And the columns are the different stages with slightly more granularity, but the color coding tells you which stage they're in, the blue, yellow, green, red. And across these 16 recommendations that we looked at, there is an aggregate of 220 items which these recommendations say thou shalt report. 220, okay? Of that, 104 are about how you develop your model, how you do your testing and training, which is a bit absurd. There's only four things that we say as a community about how shall we assess utility. Practically nothing about the deployment or workload analysis. The words exactly don't match, but that's what it is, the deployment design, workload analysis. And then a few things around fairness, about 10 recommendations. It's a little bit shocking as a community that if we care so much about fairness and equity, why are we worrying so much about how we did our training and testing?
Nigam, this is a fantastic table. I love it. And it's I'm particularly struck not only by the model fairness aspect, which is underdone, but also the utility assessment. That is fairly amazing. So I just have a simple question. Does this wonderful table appear in one of the aforementioned publications?
Not in the previously mentioned ones, but if you just Google for the title, this is on Med Archive. And it is under review right now at JAMA Network Open. But yeah, so the table, this is figure one of the manuscript titled Low Adherence to Reporting Recommendations. All right, so that's the state of the affair, state of the art. And I was like, okay, we got to do something about this now. So what we chose to do is to put out this end-to-end example of each of these steps. So in the case of the advanced care planning being guided by mortality predictions, you know, I already showed you the workflow and the model being that little red box inside. The formulation of the model in this case had to be a new one because we needed to predict the chance of someone dying in the next 3 to 12 months. And this is as of 2018. After that, now there are off-the-shelf models available, for example, from Epic that give you one-year mortality. So if you were doing something today, I would say just test that one out to see if it could work for you. Model training and testing, we did a whole bunch of stuff from gradient-boosted models to lassos to deep neural nets. Got into MIT tech review saying we're using deep neural nets to predict mortality. Which was a true statement, but wasn't actually being used in the hospital. And on the right-hand side, where my mouse cursor is, we're just looking at the calibration of the model by certain subgroups, sex, male, female, black, non-black, to see if our predicted probabilities match up with what is happening in practice. Down here is sort of the IT feasibility, can we get the data in time? And I could regale you with all sorts of stories about, we needed 33 tables, and some of them, if we wanted them at 4:30 a.m., it would take down the reporting system. So we get some of them in the morning, the 7 that you see on screen here, and then the rest come back to us. So the 26 tables come at 7:30 p.m. And we had to adjust our predictions mechanisms to handle data coming in two tranches. Then on the green phase, in the case of advanced care planning, it turned out there was actually a randomized controlled trial where someone had estimated the net benefit, the benefit of following up with a true positive, the cost of following up with a false positive, the cost of a true negative and a true positive, and a false positive. So we got all those four numbers, inflation adjusted them, and then given our model's performance, convinced ourselves that taking an action based on the model, so that's this blue dot here, is better than either taking action on everybody, that's the red line, and or nobody, that's the yellow line. And then in that same analysis, we, and I'll show you a detailed version of this in a second, we looked at if we're just marching down the list, so that's this count of positive cases going from 0 to 100, and we're calculating unit utility as we march down our list, how far down the list will we get? That's that little green rectangle says it's feasible given capacity that we'd get down, you know, about a third of, little less than a third, quarter of the way, I'm sorry, about 20%. And then we monitor this thing in practice, and we're doing a prospective evaluation that by having this trigger of flagging a patient based on their risk of passing in the next year, are the different care providers involved, physicians, occupational therapists, fellows, nurse practitioners, are they doing something? Are they completing the advanced care planning process? And does the system have the impact we hope? So what I'll do is I'll walk you through some of the detailed on this portion that I'm just highlighting. And the blue stuff, we'll sort of not dive into it further. Okay. So the model development, you know, this is where the majority of the action tends to be in the publication space. So what I'm showing you on screen is sort of six plots of three different models each. The top one is the one that actually runs in practice, the lasso, because it's good enough. In the middle is the deep neural net. And you can see on this plot here that where my mouse cursor is, that it's a little bit less calibrated, even though you might get slightly higher performance. You know, we examine the effect of data density and how, you know, if you require three or more visits and how you set your index time, like 50 different kinds of analyses. And in the end, did some evaluation using held out test sets to convince ourselves that the model is good. As in the equation linking the inputs to the outputs is okay. Five or six papers coming out of this, lots of press. And when we're working on this, somebody somewhere always mentioned the word interpretability, saying if it's a black box, we can't use it. And I got annoyed enough by it that I wrote up this blog post and the URL below will take you there. Interpretability has three meanings. There's this engineer's interpretability of how did the model produce the output. There's the trust-inducing interpretability, where you believe that if I understand it, I can choose to trust it or not. And then there's the causal interpretability that tells you exactly why is that input causing the output. There are very few things in life that are actually in this middle, you know, at the intersection of all three. What typically ends up happening is that this engineer's interpretability is offered when the user is asking either for trust or causality. And that just leads to a comical array of conversations. And this blog post outlines a few of those comical examples of how things can go horribly wrong. There's actually an elegant study from Microsoft Research showing that often when you have interpretability that triggers trust and leads the person to ignore the mistakes of the model. And they use an example of pricing apartments in New York using an interpretable model of, you know, square footage, bedrooms and bathrooms. And then they show a ridiculous apartment that's 600, 700 square feet four bedrooms, four bathrooms, or something like that. And the person trusts the price output from the model because, you know, it's an interpretable model. And when it was a black box, they caught the mistakes much, much better. So the point of this slide and the reason I'm spending like 2 minutes on it is that as you go in your adventures deploying models, really question whether interpretability is needed and what kind of interpretability is needed. Because the wrong kind can actually backfire. Okay, so then we looked at fairness. On the left is the just a zoom in of the little plot I already showed you. The performance model predicted probability plotted against true probability, and then analyzing the breakdown by subgroups. On the right is a model from a source that shall remain unnamed, but that is basically the state of the art for the most of the time. The good news is that it's equally miscalibrated for everybody. But the bad news is that it is miscalibrated. So on fairness, the one thing I would like to sort of add here is that depending on which community you hail from, there's about 20 different mathematical definitions of what constitutes fairness. All of them defined in terms of properties of the model. Two parts to it. There's, is there a systematic error? You group for that, or the map accrual when that is assigned based on the model. Those are two separate things. And what we typically have is the avoidance of a systematic difference in a
Nigam, I'm going to ask you to switch off your video. I'm going to ask you to switch off your video because it's getting choppy again, and I want people to hear you clearly.
Can you hear me now? Okay. So where I was going with this is that fairness is typically articulated as avoiding a systematic difference in the output of the model, the equation. But what we really care about is avoidance of a system, the benefit. And that is inextricably tied to the policy by which you trigger the intervention. And so I'm increasingly becoming a fan of work by another faculty member here, Sharad Goel, where they call this learning to be fair. And the point being to look at the consequences of your decision-making given your model. So on the x-axis here is the percentage of population receiving some intervention, whatever that might be, advanced care planning or statins or what have you. And the y-axis, the number of desirable outcomes you obtained. So heart attacks prevented if you're doing statins, or advanced care planning if you're doing the ACP work, or goals of care documentation if you're doing the ACP work. And then just look at different policies. If you do random allocation, excuse me, what will happen? If you accomplish parity, what would happen? If you equalize the false negative rate, maximize utility, maximize outcomes. So by, excuse me. So by doing the consequences of the decision-making, we can get a handle on the interplay between the model and the policy. And I think we need to do that routine based and not sort of pretend that by just looking at the output of the model and ensuring that the statistical properties of that are good, we're going to achieve fairness. That's here. Okay. Then, of course, there's crosses, way many more things than just fairness. And so in this particular case, it had ethical concerns with kind of machine learning to guide landscape planning, interviewed a whole bunch of stakeholders, the model builders, patients, advocates, healthcare providers, insurance companies, regulators. The nuggets of insights we got is like patients, for example, didn't give a damn about interpretability. In some cases, they didn't even want to know the output. The doctor, as long as the doctor gets, that's what I care about. Very counterintuitive. So this kind of, and of course, it'll be use case dependent. Will be things in which patients will care about it. Routinely, we are what are the stakeholders really want? And the stakeholder desires are in conflict. And we'll have to resolve conflict by some of which we don't currently handle on. Usefulness and capacity, I already walked you through these plots. Just a blow up of that, we now view this as a usefulness dashboard, should be routinely done, that given models AUROC and your estimates of the cost of action, the cost of inaction, and so on, just do the math and figure and make sure that model guided decision making is beneficial and make sure that you have the capacity to follow up with enough number of flagged cases that will realize that potentiality that you've captured. This one is going a little deeper on this utility calculation, and I'll probably not spend time on it and only say that the workflow had 21 steps. They could, so we ran a simulation of 500 days of throughput through the hospital. And then on each day, a different step fails with a different error, with a different probability. And then we're just plotting in each of these plots, the rightmost is the best. And then as things fall apart, so that's why I call it simulating achievable benefit. Just a sort of a double click on this plot on the right to make sure that it's appropriate and the workflow is robust. Because if you have a particular, the whole thing falls apart, you know, up front. Reliability, what's on screen are two plots. The order is regular model. That dashed line is
Nigam. Nigam, we're having
and the solid line is, yeah,
we're having bandwidth issues. Why don't we move back one slide, and I apologize, move back one slide and we'll take a little pause for the currents of the internet to catch up with you, and let's go. All right, I could follow you all the way towards the almost the very end of this slide. Uh-oh, what's happening here?
I think we just lost Nigam.
Oh, well. I'm very sorry, everybody. I found that a very interesting presentation, but unfortunately, it got harder to understand when it got choppy. Let's see if he returns to us in a minute. If he doesn't, I'll just use up a bit of air. Ah, there he is. He's back. Nigam, we see you. We don't hear you.
All right. Now.
We see you, Nigam. But we don't see your presentation. All right.
Do you see the slide now?
Now we see the slide. Yes, thank you.
Okay. Yeah, it's like, you know, 500 gigabytes. Not connectivity to Amazon for Zoom.
Strange stuff.
One is a little simulation that as we go steps of that workflow with, you know, 21 steps and so on, and the different colored plots are a different, and how much does that affect you, Nigam, in terms of taking you down from the best case scenario?
Nigam, I apologize, but you keep breaking up, and I think it's becoming increasingly challenging for the audience. So I recommend that we move now to the discussion. So if you stop your screen sharing and just keep the audio channel on, we'll jump straight to the discussion. Great. And so
sounds good.
So other than for the future, hoping that Stanford can discover the merits of better broadband, and maybe the ITU can help consult for the better brand broadband delivery, I'll start out with the, asking my own question, and then the rest of the audience can weigh in through the Q&A window. So my question for you is, you're involved not only on this Stanford end, but in companies that are in the various parts of this machine learning AI delivery process. And you mentioned the almighty workflow, but you did point out that the interpretability requirements seem to be somewhat overblown, or rather that when patients are asked how they feel about interpretability, they are less than compelled. My own sense from talking to doctors is for things that they trust, even though they're black boxes, like an MRI, other than the output, they're quite happy not to have interpretability. Nonetheless, out there in the real world, what kind of interpretability do you think is being asked for, whether for a marketing reason or for a regulatory compliance reason, and how are you dealing with that?
So interpretability, you're absolutely right that once a clinician has trust, they don't really care much about the interpretability. And a nice case in point is the venerated cell sorter, which does our CBC for us. And there was a time probably when Zach, you count the number of lymphocytes and eosinophils in a microscope with a counter in your hand, you know, punching the counts through. Right, we have a machine that has an algorithm that stands in the stead of a human being and produces the count. So very definition of AI replacing a human. And most doctors today can't really explain exactly how the damn thing works. But we've calibrated it, we've tested it, and convinced ourselves that it works. So my view, and it's an opinion, I don't have a theoretical proof for this, is that what clinicians want is proof that the thing works as advertised and they can rely on it. Interpretability is a crutch to that. But there are other ways to get to trust and reliability, such as by doing a prospective randomized trial.
I think that's very sensible and it's very well put. Other than Judy Kuriansky, who wants to figure out how to reach you offline about a project, I see a question by Carla DeGucci. She says, did you compare subgroups of men and women in the initial definition of the data to use for training? If yes, do you find biases between these groups?
Short answer, yes, we did compare. And in that particular case, there were no biases because death affects men and women practically equally.
Right. And of course, I'm sure that's not going to be the case for events that typically only happen to women or only happen to men because of anatomic differences, for example. Judy clarified, she wants Matthias to reach out to her to, okay, good. So thank you for that answer, Nigam. A question from Judy. Very good question. It is conceivable that the models that you're developing are transportable across the United States. But I can imagine under a very different reimbursement regime, where different levels of acuity are required for admission, where different things are paid for or not, you might have a different population ascertainment coming into the hospital at different levels of morbidity or sickness. How are you thinking about making these models generalized internationally?
So I would label this my favorite question. I think as a community, we have tied ourselves in knots by imposing generalizability requirements when they should simply not exist. And that comes from the way doctors are trained. There's this assumption of causality. So the pooled cohort equation with its variables comprising blood pressure and cholesterol levels and smoking status is a representation of the underlying biological process causing heart attacks. And we believe that that process works the same way in all human beings, and therefore that equation should work equally well here and in India, for example. But when you get to models where the inputs are operational items, there should be no expectation whatsoever that their outputs, that function that's linking operational inputs to some output, should generalize from here to Oslo to Mumbai. And what should generalize is the procedure by which you learn the function and the manner in which you evaluate it and watch it year over year to make sure it's still working at your site. And we've actually done this experiment where we trained a classifier for 10 different phenotypes at Columbia, at Stanford, and at Aja University in Korea. And then when we exchanged the classifiers as is across the sites, as Zach was saying, you know, US to US transfer, you know, 5-10% percent performance drop, but it still works. You go international, it's like 30-40% performance drop, right? I mean, it basically becomes useless. But if you redefine the labeling function at that site and retrain and relearn the function for the classifier, then you recover all the lost performance. So as a community, we should be thinking about ways in which we share the model training workflows rather than trained models.
All right, Nigam, thank you for that answer. And by the way, I think it's not only a good answer, but it's the only reasonable answer that the regulatory authorities are going to be able to, are going to have to embrace. There is very few ways in which we can have a one-size-fits-all machine learning algorithm that is triggered off of process, clinical processes. And there's a question from Madhavan Palan. How do we work with unstructured data in this topic? Thanks. I presume they're talking about narrative text. Nigam, over to you.
Yeah, so unstructured data are a source of additional features or X's in that function. So in some cases, you know, let's say you're trying to identify women with a high-risk pregnancy, there are certain features that you need to extract, such as the number of prior pregnancies a woman has had, were there complications at that time? And those things do not exist in ICD, CPT, or those kinds of coding hierarchies. So you need to extract them from the textual data. So in this mindset, text is yet another source.
Okay, thank you, Nigam. You managed to freeze, but I think you gave the answer. We are now 3 minutes before the end of the hour. I want to thank Matthias and his colleagues at the ITU for having organized a tremendously successful and interesting series. This fall, I found myself learning quite a bit, including, despite all the internet hiccups, just listening to Nigam really helped me think about some of the questions that, frankly, our colleagues at the ITU will and should be thinking about because of some of the regulatory issues that devolve from the communicating and using these distributed procedures internationally. So with that, thanks for you and our organizers, and I guess Harvard Medical School as well, as being one of the co-sponsors. I want to wish everybody a successful close to 2021. And I hope, although it at the moment feels a little bit of a vain hope, but I hope that in 2022, we can find ourselves together in person so that we can have a more extended and non-electronically mediated version of this discussion. So everybody have a great, great weekend and happy New Year.
Thank you very much, Zach. I'll take it on from here for one or two closing sentences. Thank you also, Nigam, Zoom engineers on holiday already, as you write in the chat. We are going to launch a really brief survey. So if everybody can just click on a number, if you'd recommend our webinar series, and that'll help us, you know, evaluate it. And as Zach said, we're going to sit together and think about amazing speakers for next year that'll be of interest to you. The next AI and Health webinar will be on January 13th on a super interesting topic, refusing AI contact, autism, algorithms, and the dangers of technoscience. So tune in on January 13th. And with that said, thanks again, Nigam. Thank you, Zach. Have a great end of the year and hope to see you next time. Goodbye, everyone. Rewind selector.
Rewind selector. Rewind selector. Rewind selector. Rewind selector. Rewind selector. Rewind selector.